Ah yes, World of Warcraft, the biggest MMO on the market for the past 16 years. You think about starting out and just don't know where or how to start? I promise you, you have clicked exactly the right video. I'm Cheetor and I've been playing this game for 12 years. I'm here to give you some much needed help with the first few hours in the game. I'll help you out with choosing a race and a class, I'll explain the interface, the combat and how the most important features of this game work. I tried to make this guide as comprehensive and understandable as possible, but if you have any further questions, feel free to ask in the comments below. I will try my very best to answer every single question that comes up. Let me first explain that when you start playing World of Warcraft, you won't have to work your way through 16 years worth of updates. Unlike some other MMOs out there, the expansions this game receives are not stacked on top of each other. In World of Warcraft, there's almost a kind of fresh start every time a new expansion comes out. While you won't have to level a new character, the level cap gets raised, making previous content outdated. You can focus on the content of the current expansion and come back later to explore the older expansions on your own. With this out of the way, let's jump right in. Your very first character. At this point, I assume that you have already downloaded and installed the game and you want to log in for the very first time. The very first choice you will have to make is the server on which you will play. A server is a separate instance of World of Warcraft on which your character exists with other characters on the same server. While this choice was incredibly impactful in the past, Blizzard has introduced a lot of systems to make playing across different servers possible. There are some things going on behind the scenes, but to sum it all up, let me give you the following advice. If you already have friends that are playing WoW and you primarily want to play with them, ask them what server they play on and choose that one. If you want to focus on the role-playing aspect of the game and want to play with people that have primarily similar interests, I advise you to play on one of the servers marked as RP. If you have no idea what you are getting yourself into, pick a server with a cool name and a population of at least medium. While you can play on a server with a lower population, it might make a few things way later in the game a little more cumbersome. Smaller servers generally don't have a huge thriving economy, and playing on a big server will make it easier in the long run to find a guild and find friends to play with. So, you've picked a server. WoW will now ask you to create your very first character. There are quite some choices on the screen, so let me explain everything. On the left and the right side, you can pick your race. While picking a race comes with certain benefits, I absolutely advise you to go with a race that you find visually or thematically appealing. Unfortunately, not every class is available on every race, but more on that in a second. Picking a race will align you with one of the two factions in World of Warcraft, so this is already one of the biggest choices you will have to make. You will not be able to play with players on the other faction in any meaningful way, so if you want to play with your friends, make sure you end up on the same side. Some races are also locked behind progression in the later part of the game, so for now you will only have access to the basic races of the game. Now comes the biggest choice you will have to make. Your class. There are currently 12 classes in the game. I will give you a quick overview of what they are about, but let me first explain the so-called Holy Trinity. In a lot of games, there are three different roles that define your purpose in group combat: healers, tanks, and damage dealers, which are generally called DPS, short for damage per second. Healers generally heal and support the rest of the group, and damage dealers dish out high amounts of damage to enemy mobs or players. Tanks are the frontliners that take away the attention from enemy groups to focus them instead of their allies. They have high health pool and are generally incredibly sturdy. Usually tanks lead the groups in dungeons, so if you are someone that wants to take on that extra bit of responsibility, go for it. But they also require you to invest that extra bit of research to make sure you don't lead your groups into bad situations. While I don't want to advise specifically against playing a certain role, tanking is probably the role that I would least advise for someone that has never played an MMO before. Okay, so for the classes. In WoW, every class has at least three different specializations, with at least one of the choices being a DPS spec. While they aren't always perfectly balanced out,
This shouldn't concern you in the beginning, since the balance of the game is constantly in flux, and what might be a slightly weaker choice right now might be incredibly powerful in the next week. Specializations unlock at level 10. While you are not in combat, you can change the specialization of your class at any time, so feel free to experiment with them. Enough rambling, let me give you the overview. Warriors most closely resemble a mix of a standard soldier and a berserker. They have two different melee DPS specs, Fury and Arms, and a tanking spec called Protection. They use a resource called Rage, which builds over time as they hit enemies and get hit by them. It enables them to deal devastating amounts of damage in close range. They also have quite some tools to stay close to their enemies. They can charge enemies on range and leap over a short distance. Fury makes them dual wield huge two-handed weapons and leads more into a berserker style gameplay. Arms focuses on using a single big hitting weapon that they can also throw around. They use abilities that increase their damage they deal in a short window of time. Protection is your stereotypical sword and board frontliner that does really well in reducing damage by blocking enemy attacks and controlling the flow of the battle with AoE, short for Area of Effect Control, like Shockwave. Warriors can turn into a so-called avatar that increases their DPS for a short amount of time. Hunters have three different DPS specs, two of them being ranged and one being melee. They have access to a huge array of wild beasts that are tameable across the whole world. So if you like that, hunters are the perfect class for you. While their range spec, Marksman, focuses on shooting enemies with bows and lining up big hitting, well-placed shots, their melee spec Survival partners them up with their pet to assault enemies up close. Survival also has access to different kinds of traps and bombs. Their Beastmaster range spec makes the pet the star of the show, regularly empowering it and even gaining access to his second pet. Beastmasters have the ability to use exotic, incredibly rare pets that you have to chase down in remote locations of the world. Mages have three different ranged DPS specs. They are your well-known fantasy caster and all their specs focus on one element. Fire has some of the biggest hitting spells in the game and focuses on chaining together big critical strikes, enabling them to instantly cast spells and burn their opponents. Frost mages assault enemies with icy shards and have access to a frosty water elemental as a pet. They can freeze enemies in place and freeze themselves in an ice block, preventing damage. Arcane mages use their mana bar as a resource for increased damage and have a mostly turrety gameplay style, where they stand still and cast highly damaging spells into their opponents, looking exceptionally flashy on the way. Rogues. If you like to be sneaky, you'll enjoy a rogue. They have three melee DPS specs and have access to stealth in every single one of them, hiding you from enemy eyes. Subtlety rogues focus on stealthing around and empowering their daggers with dark magic. Assassination rogues poison their enemy with a wide variety of available toxins and bleeds. Outlaw rogues would best be described as pirates, as they use hooks, guns and dual-wield swords or axes. All three of them are fast-paced melee attackers. They use a combination of an energy bar that quickly refills and combo points, a resource that builds up through ability usage during combat and gives them access to different stunts and finishers. Priest. Priests are the only class in the game that has access to two different healing specs, Holy being your stereotypical healer. They have access to a vast arrangement of tools for different situations and are well equipped to handle a lot of different situations. When they die, they turn into an angelic creature, enabling them to keep healing for a short period of time. Discipline. A little harder to explain, but they put magic shields on their allies to absorb damage and have one of the most unique styles of healing. They usually don't heal their allies with direct spells, but through damaging opponents with holy and shadow magic. They bring the highest damage of all healing specializations in the game. Priest's last spec is Shadow, which focuses on void and shadow magic and is considered a DOT class. DOT is short for damage over time, which means they will apply several debuffs to their opponents that makes them take damage every few seconds. Warlocks. All three Warlock specs are ranged casters and they have access to different demons that they can summon. While we were just at the topic of dots, Affliction is the most dot-heavy spec in the game. If you like managing debuffs on your opponents and like to see your enemy's health tick down inevitably, you'll really enjoy Affliction Warlocks. Destruction has the biggest hitting abilities in the game, even before Fire Mages. During combat, you will build up a resource that you can spend on huge finishers like Chaos Bolt. They specialize in chaos and fire magic. A demonology focuses on the ability to summon a lot of demons. If you like summoner builds in other games, this one is for you. Druid. This is the most flexible class. They are the only class in the game that has access to 4 different specializations to cover every role in the game. They can tank, heal, melee DPS and ranged DPS. They can shapeshift into different animals and are generally closely aligned with nature. Their tanking spec, Guardian, turns them into a bear in which they have one of the highest health pools in the game. For Feral, their melee DPS spec, they can turn into a cat, focusing on bites and bleeds. In cat form, they can use combo points like rogues and have access to stealth. If you want to be a ranged DPS druid, you can spec into Balance, generally referred to by the community as Moonkin or Boomkin. You will use a combination of nature and arcane spells that are empowered by the moon and the sun. A druid heals in Restoration, a healing build that focuses on HOTS, the exact opposite of DOTS. They heal over time and after they apply their healing spells, they can use their versatile toolset to assist their group while they watch their party's health go up. Paladins. These are holy crusaders that have access to a healing tree, a tank tree, and a melee DPS spec. They have access to the most amount of supporting spells that empower their allies and parties. Holy is a healer that wants to be in melee range at most times and would be referred to as a combat medic in other games. They heal more the closer they are to their allies and have a toolkit in which they will use damaging melee abilities to empower their healing. They can be considered the melee counterpart to Discipline Priests. Protection. Imagine a protection warrior empowered by the light. They can increase their defensive values through holy abilities and have access to a lot of group healing to help their party out. Their trademark spell is an ability that makes them throw their shield towards enemies, making it bounce between them and then come right back to the paladin. Retribution. Wielding a two-handed weapon, Retribution paladins build up holy power. Similar to combo points, they build up their power and then unleash huge melee finishes onto their enemies. They are known for their big damage increasing cooldowns that they can stack on top of each other to unleash incredible amounts of damage in a short time frame. Shamans. Masters of the Elements, Shamans have 2 DPS and 1 healing spec. They use totems to support their allies and have access to different elemental pets that they can call when needed. Elemental uses all of the different elements to their advantage. If you like lightning, earthquakes and lava eruptions, you will sure enjoy this range caster spec. Enhancement is a dual wielding melee specialization in which the Shaman empowers their weapons with the elements and is a fluid, fast paced melee spec. They primarily use lightning melee abilities, but they have access to different other elements as well. Restoration is a healing spec that uses the elements water and earth to heal the group. They specialize in healing closely stacked parties through the use of healing rain and chain heal. Monks. Added in the Mists of Pandaria expansion, these are martial artists that align themselves with certain celestial gods and draw a lot of inspiration from Eastern mythology. Like paladins, they have access to a healing, a melee and a tanking build. Swift and Nimble, their melee spec is called Windwalker and they use different martial arts and chi to do damage to close enemies. They have incredible mobility, can clone themselves and get assistance from a divine tiger. Monks that tank are called Brewmaster. They use kegs of alcohol and a fiery breath to incinerate enemy packs. Their trademark ability is Stagger, a passive ability that makes them take big parts of the damage they take over a longer period of time instead of at once. Like Windwalkers, they are quite mobile. Mistweaver monks heal their allies through meditative abilities and regenerative mists. They have a more stationary healing style in which they channel a primary heal into their target that enables their other spells to be instantly cast. They also have the ability to assist their party in melee combat when no healing is required. Death Knights. Added in the Wrath of the Lich King, Death Knights aren't available right from the start. but to compensate, they start at a higher level. Death Knights are fallen knights that are aligned with the Lich King. They use a rune system that enables them to use their abilities with a quick recharge rate. They have 2 melee DPS and 1 tanking specialization called Blood. They tank by surrounding themselves with bony shields that increase their survivability, but they are most known for their incredible self-healing capabilities. They can heal a big portion of the damage they recently took and suck the life force from close enemies. They are one of the most self-reliant tanks in the game and rival the healing output from designated healers. Frost. Dual-wielding ice-enchanted weapons, they use frosty spells and have big hitting melee abilities. They can call down a dragon that breathes ice in its path and are generally considered one of the most fluid melee classes. They have a play style that is quite easy to grasp. A little more complex is the Unholy Death Knight. Using diseases, corpses and undead pets, these guys generally focus on dealing damage over a longer period of time. They permanently have access to a ghoul that they can transform into a big abomination, and they can call down a gargoyle to increase their damage. The last class, Demon Hunter, was only added recently in the Legion expansion. Like Death Knights, they are only available at a higher level. They are incredible class for solo adventurers. Their melee DPS spec Havoc has a pretty straightforward playstyle. It's really fast, you transform into a huge demon to increase your DPS, fire a laser from your eyes, dash around and do huge amounts of area of effect damage. They tank as Vengeance, where they can grow spikes to increase their defense, turn into a huge, almost unkillable demon, and control enemies with the runes they place on the ground called sigils. Almost like blood DKs, they have really high self-healing, but they also boast the highest mobility of any tank. Choosing a class from this vast arrangement of different playstyles might seem daunting at first, but don't worry, you can experiment as much as you want and find the perfect class for you. Most players play several different classes and it's not uncommon for new players to try out a few different ones until they find the one that fits them perfectly. World of Warcraft is a game you can enjoy for years to come, and spending some time in the beginning to get a grasp on what every class is about isn't a waste of time. One quick note before we continue here, you might see a shiny button that enables you to boost your character to the level cap instantly. While you can use that as you wish, I generally advise new players to level their first characters by themselves. Since Shadowlands, Blizzard has revamped the leveling process and it will only take you a few days until you reach a pretty high level. Skipping the leveling phase on your very first character might leave you confused, as you will start out in the endgame with all of your spells and talents unlocked. I've heard several times that this experience can be incredibly overwhelming for new players. If you are an experienced MMO player, feel free to boost a character if you feel confident in your ability to figure all the stuff out. You can now customize your character however you want, but don't sweat it, you will have the ability to change your in-game experience, including your gender, basically for free whenever you want later in the game. At this point, I hope you have created your first character and you didn't spend half the day figuring out a cool name. If you did, trust me, you're not alone. You clicked login and now you're in Azeroth for the very first time. While you used to start in your race's starting zone, all new players will now start on Exile's Reach when they level up for the first few times. This is a zone designed to teach you the basics of the game and will seamlessly transfer you into the rest of the world a little later. On your other characters, you will be able to level through any of the old expansion zones if you wish to do so. First things first, move your character with WASD, control your camera angle freely by holding left click and moving the mouse. When you hold right click instead, your character will turn in the same direction your camera is facing. If you want to interact with an NPC or an object, use your right mouse button. When you hover over interactables, your cursor will change in color or form. Talk to the NPC with the exclamation mark and accept your very first quest. World of Warcraft works with a targeting system. That means, with very few exceptions, you don't have to aim your abilities. You can left click on an enemy in the open world and it will appear next to your health and mana as your so-called target. Every offensive single target spell you will use now will be cast onto your target. Later on, you will have some other options to target people, but I will get to that when needed. Okay, so how do we use our spells? Currently, there is a single action bar at the bottom of the screen with only a few abilities. Once we get more spells, we have the option to add more bars to our interface. Your standard hotkeys on the first action bar range from 1 to 9. If you have regular size hands, you might reach up to 5 or 6. Anything beyond that is in the most literal sense of the word a stretch. I will explain how to change your hotkeys later in the guide. an important thing on keybinds or hotkeys, whatever you want to call them right here. While there are some players, even veteran ones, that use their mouse to click their abilities, I would really advise you to learn how to use your keyboard for spell usage as early as possible. It gives you several huge advantages later in the game when you need to use your abilities quickly, and it also keeps your eyes mostly on your character and the enemies. Also, it makes playing the game way more comfortable for most players. Now, for your first quest, right-click the training dummies and use your ability. Once you've defeated the powerful dummy, go back to the NPC and turn in the quest. Congrats, you just did your first quest. Now follow a few tutorial quests that can all be completed on the ship. Work your way through them and you should end up on level 2 and land on an island. You will gain a new ability that gets automatically added to your action bar. Make sure to read every new ability you get to get an idea what they do. Accept the next quest. When you don't know where to go for a quest, look at either the minimap in the top right corner or on the world map that you can open with M for directions. They will be marked either by a number in a circle or a blue overlay that indicates the area where you can get the quest done. Right-click defeated enemies to gather their loot. Then click on the items in the small pop-up window to add them to your inventory. If you want to automatically loot everything in there, hold shift down when you right-click the corpse. Very recently, there was also a quest marker added that shows you exactly where you need to go on your screen, so if you ever get lost, try finding that location. I know some players can get confused by the looting system. If you have several corpses in close proximity, you will automatically see combined loot of all of them, a system that is referred to as AoE looting. You will probably level up again really soon, so take a look at your abilities once more. On your next quest, you will need to use an item on an NPC. Left-click the NPC and either open your inventory and right-click the item, or look in your quest window for any quest-related items and left-click it. While you make your way through the next few quests, I will explain some different parts of the user interface for you. While until now you left-clicked enemies, you also have the ability to press Tab, the button above your caps lock key, to target and cycle through the nearest enemies. This will make it easier to switch between enemies when there are several attacking you. If you press C, you open your character page, including all your gear and attributes. These will play a role later on, for now you probably won't have items with stats on them. Pressing B opens and closes your bags. Pressing P opens your spellbook. It shows you which spells you already have and which ones you will gain along the way. There's one window for class-wide abilities and three windows for abilities you gain when you are in a certain specialization. I will now let you do the next few quests on your own. While you do them, you might come across a star icon on your map. These usually indicate rare or boss monsters that give you higher than average and sometimes really valuable rewards. You can defeat most of them on your own, so you can always give it a shot. Some of them might take a while to take down, depending on how much health they have. Later on, you will get turned into an ogre and the quest wants you to slash wave. I've seen several players struggle with this, so open your chat with enter and type in slash wave and press enter again. While slash commands have several functions, the primary one for you will be emotes. You can communicate and have fun with other players with emotes ranging from slash wave to slash dance, slash chicken and way more. Just try some out in front of the ogres. After completing all of the quests in the ogre citadel, you will be asked to open the group finder to enter the dungeon Dark Maul Citadel. Press either I or click the little I in the menu to open it. This is the dungeon finder. Currently there is only one tab available. On the top of the window there are all three roles displayed. You can choose here which role you want to play during a dungeon. If a certain role isn't available for your class, it will be grayed out. If you check the mark under the green flag, you will be eligible for leading the dungeon. If you have no experience with WoW so far, let some other people take the responsibility. For this dungeon though, you can only play DPS, so choose that and click find group. This dungeon is a story dungeon that will play out with the rest of the group of NPCs that you have gathered so far, so don't be scared. Follow your group through the first two rooms until you encounter the first boss. This dungeon has a few mechanics that are meant to teach new players very basic mechanics, so let me explain, just in case you want to know. When Tank casts Seismic Slam, he will turn towards you and unleash a shockwave in front of him, so you can move to his side to avoid the damage. Move out of the swirling brown ground effects. When Tank casts Interrupt interrupting shout, stop your current spell cast by either moving or pressing escape. Getting interrupted on a spell with a cast time means you cannot cast spells for the next few seconds. These mechanics probably won't kill you, but it's good practice to pay attention to abilities like these from the very start just to get used to them. On the way up the ramp, avoid the purple swirlies. Up there, you will find the final boss. At first, he will summon a few adds, short for additional monsters, that you will have to kill. When you defeat him, an undead dragon will spawn. Move away from its front when he casts Necrotic Breath. With him dead, you have now completed your very first dungeon. Turn in the quest and you get a new one to fly to either Stormwind or Orgrimmar, depending on your faction. These cities are the major capitals of the Alliance and the Horde. If you wanna explore Exile's Reach some more, make sure to do so right now before you leave, because you will not be able to go back here. Congratulations, you have now completed the very first zone of the game. Theoretically, from this point on, you could do whatever you want. At this point, everything in the world is available, but to keep things in line, I advise you to follow the quests that are now available. You will be able to take a guided tour through Stormwind or Orgrimmar right now. On screen, you will see me do the tour through Stormwind, but it will mostly be the same in Orgrimmar. While you do that, I wanna explain some more things. At this point, you should be level 10, so you can now choose a specialization by opening the talent menu with N or pressing the small book in the menu. For every spec, it will show you some of the core abilities you will unlock as you level up. Select Activate and you are suddenly a Protection Paladin or a Holy Paladin. I'm going to select Protection for the purpose of this guide, but pick whatever you want for your class. As outlined in the class overview before, you can change your spec whenever you want, so feel free to try all your specs out. You will have a separate action bar for every spec, so customize them however you feel fit. As you can see, all of my new abilities get thrown onto my action bars now. This is also a great time to talk about action bars and hotkeys, since your basic action bar should be pretty close to full now. First of all, press escape to open the game menu. Click interface and then click action bars. For now, check the marks on the bottom left and bottom right bar. Close the menu again. Now press P to open the spellbook. You now also have the abilities from your new specialization to your avail. You can drag and drop abilities from the book into the action bar if they haven't been put there automatically. In case you can't move abilities between your bars, go to Interface, Action Bars again, and uncheck Lock Bars. Now that you have all your abilities in place, it's time for you to learn how to keybind. Open the game menu again. Click on Keybinds. For now, we are going to click on Quick Keybind Mode. Mouse over an ability that you want to keybind and press the key. I will make a separate in-depth guide to keybinds, but here is a quick overview. In general, you want to use all the buttons around WASD for spells. Additionally, you can use so-called modifiers, namely Control, Shift and Alt for additional keybinds. For example, you can bind your leftmost ability to Shift 1 to make it easy to remember. You can use all sorts of keybinds, but mostly players choose to use at least Q, E and F plus any available extra mouse buttons in combination with different modifiers. Don't worry though, and just find some that are comfortable. You will find some combinations are quite acrobatic at first, but over time you'll get used to it as you build up the muscle memory for your abilities. I've seen some weird people use Shift 8, which I don't even know how it's possible, but your keybinds are for you, there are no rules. You can keybind everything that isn't on your action bar under keybinds. If you want, you can explore what is keybindable and what's not, but I promise you, if you don't want to, you probably don't have to click a single thing in World of Warcraft ever again. Enough of the interface for now, I could make a 2-hour video on the basic interface on its own, so let's keep going. Back to your tour. You will be guided through your faction's capital city now, and if you didn't meet any players up until now, you can be certain that you'll see a lot of people here. You will automatically join a few chat channels in the bottom left window, but for now you can ignore those. Follow your guide and you will soon arrive at the Stable Master. Here, you will get your very first mount depending on your race. Now, if this won't make traveling easier. To access your collection of mounts, press Shift P or click on the horse icon on the menu bar. You will then be guided to your class trainer. This might sound weird, but class trainers don't really serve a purpose anymore nowadays and are only there to explain your specializations. Your next step will lead you to a tavern, where you will place your hearthstone. A hearthstone is an item that allows you to always return to this exact place from all over the world. You can place it down in every inn or major city. It can never be used up, so use it as many times as you want. You will later get similar items that allow you to easily travel through the world, follow the rest of the main quest until you get sent to the docks. Here, your new player experience will end and you will be sent to either Kal Tiras or Zandalar to begin your true journey out in the world. You have now learned how to move your character, use your abilities and change your specialization. We went over the most important UI elements, how to queue for a dungeon and how to set up your action bars including hotkeys. You are now in a great position to travel the world at your own pace and explore everything you want to. This concludes the first part of a series of new player guides that will be released over the coming weeks. The next video in the series will teach you the basics of group play in dungeons and interactions with other players. So if you want to learn more about that, make sure to watch that video as well. If you have any further questions, feel free to ask below or visit me on twitch.tv/cheater and ask me live on stream. Well, I sure hope you enjoyed your stay and wish you a great journey in the ever-evolving world of Warcraft.